Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Welcome to lecture number 16, which is the second lecture of capsule number 8. Before I start this lecture, I want to share with you some interesting things about the person who has created the content for this course. This is Dr. Rahul Goyal, who is currently a research assistant in the University of Houston. He was one of our very distinguished undergraduate students, joined in 2004, and after one semester of stay in IIT Bombay, when most students want to go home, he came along with his friend and said, I don't want to go home because all my friends have gone to various engineering colleges, medical colleges, there is nobody at home. I want to do something. So I said, you are so fresh, just fresh into engineering, forget about aero. But he was highly enthusiastic. He insisted. So I said, okay, go home for a week so that your parents can see you and your friends and relatives can see. Then you come back. He came back with his friends. And the content that you are going to see today was first initiated in 2004. So it's very old. Okay. As a winter intern, it was done. He did many things. One of the things was to prepare this presentation. Now, today PowerPoint is very common, it's available everywhere, we do lots of animation, etc., video insertion. Go back in 2004, PowerPoint was very new. It was the latest sensation software in the market. And we had not explored PowerPoint. Prior to that, we were using transparency sheets. So this presentation was created by Rahul and his friends using my transparency sheets for this lecture and inserting some more material. So, take it from the point of view of some historical approach also. After completing his graduation in IIT Bombay, Rahul went to MIT on a fully funded master's program. After completing master's, he did many interesting things. He went to Germany for a space program, etc. And interestingly, just about, what, today is 13th, about 7 days ago, he defended his PhD at University of Houston. Okay, this is Rahul and his wife Supriti. I had the pleasure of attending his wedding last year. And he is now an expert in space physiology. So the topic of his thesis is sensory motor mechanisms underlying postural control for the astronauts. Okay, so I present to you the PPT made by Rahul and his friends on VN diagram. Okay, so these are the contents of this particular presentation. And one more interesting fact, the entire content of this presentation have also been recorded as a video lecture. So back in 2001, I think, or two, we had one education technology cell in IIT Bombay, ET cell. I can call it as the father of CDEEP basically. CDEEP has formed basically out of ET cell. And ET cell approached us, young faculty members, at that time I was quite young, 2001, to record video lectures. So I volunteered to record this lecture. It is available in the library on a VHS cassette. And I think it's also available as a soft copy. So the same lecture is already recorded. And you will find me a very young person with lot of hair and also darker in black presenting this lecture. Okay, if I locate that, I am not getting that DVD somehow. If I locate it, I am going to share with you. So what we are going to look at is definition of VN diagram. We are going to look at load factors acting on the aircraft. What are the limits on them? Remember, limits, upper limits are not necessarily just positive upper limits. There are also negative upper limits. I don't call them lower limits, I call them as a positive and negative limits. There is a concept called as corner speed, which is very important. And in the lecture that you attended on turning flight, we have discussed some formulae and methods to calculate turning rate, tightest and fastest turn. I'll come back to that. The VN diagram is of many types. One of them is called as an operational VN diagram. And then we move on to the effect of gusts or disturbances acting on the aircraft and how they generate load on it. We will look only at vertical gusts in this particular presentation, and then look at some regulations on how the gust velocity is specified, and finally how these impose limits on the VN diagram and make a limit combined envelope. Okay. Okay. So this is the VN diagram of an aircraft called HF-24 Marut, which was one of the first transonic fighter aircrafts designed in the country. It was designed by a team led by Dr. Kurt Stang from Germany and Dr. V.M. Ghatge from India and his team. At its time, during the time when it was designed, it was considered to be one of the best aircraft in the world in its category. So, what is a VN diagram? Basically, we see we have an x-axis, which is load factor. On the y, x-axis, we have the velocity. On the y-axis, we have the load factor. Okay. Now, the velocity on the x-axis is not a normal velocity, but a special velocity. And the load factor on the y-axis is also not the y-load factor, but the z-load factor, as we will see. And I want to show you the diagram first and then we will see how to derive it. So you see there are two curved lines from origin OA upwards and OB downwards. These are the two lines. There are two horizontal lines on top and bottom, which are the limits of the maximum vertical positive and maximum vertical negative load factors. And then we have a vertical line here, which is the maximum speed. And then there are some cuts here, and AP970 stands for the British regulations. They were called as aviation publications, that is AP970 was a regulatory document provided by the Britishers for military aircraft, and they gave a procedure and calculations and methodology to calculate the VN diagram. Similarly, there are other agencies who also give the requirements. Okay. So, let us take a typical aircraft in flight, and although we have shown level flight here, but it could be at any particular angle, but consider level flight. You have thrust, drag, lift and force. Do not worry about the point of action of the forces. Of course, the points are not collinear, but in the direction along the thrust line or in the forward direction, if we ignore the thrust mounting angle, we have the force T minus D. So that force T minus D upon W, aircraft weight, will be NX. Similarly, you will have lift acting on the wings, plus or minus lift acting on the tail. Mostly it will be plus lift acting on tail because tail has down load. That divided by the aircraft weight would be called as NZ or the vertical load factor. And if there is any turn with acceleration, then there is also going to be side force. So that side force divided by aircraft weight will be NY. So an aircraft typically has three load factors, NX, NZ, NY. So this already I have covered. Yes. Yeah, net force upon. Correct. Net force acting on the aircraft, external force except weight. It is except weight. It is a net force acting on the aircraft except the weight. Okay. So let us see some general points. First point is that VN diagram, when we talk about VN diagram, we are only looking at symmetrical maneuvers in the vertical plane. So can you name or describe any symmetrical maneuver in the vertical plane? that you have heard of? What is it? Barrel roll. Is it in the vertical plane? It's not. What is a barrel roll? That's not the way it is. Barrel roll is this way. So some people are moving their fingers now. There is a name for moving fingers. Yes. Anybody here knows? Yeah.
Pull-up maneuver, shore maneuver.
Yeah, dive pull-up maneuver, pull-up maneuver. We have studied that maneuver. You have answered a question in the quiz based on that. So, why is it only for the symmetrical maneuvers in the vertical plane? That means we cannot use this VN diagram for barrel rolls or for flip rolls or for any things that are not in the vertical plane. There is one maneuver called as a knife edge pass. So, you go like this and then you turn like this and you go like this. Okay. And then if you turn, it will create side force apart from the load. So, we do not consider those maneuvers, only symmetrical maneuvers, that means not even this, symmetrical maneuvers in which the wings remain level and in the vertical plane. So, basically dive pull out or a loop. So, why only for these? What do you think? This is a question, I am not going to give the answer. I want the answer to come from you. What do you think? Yes. What could be the reason? Correct. So, the question actually can be answered in many ways. One way to say is that you already told that VN diagram has NZ as the Y axis. So, that means you should have pure NZ. Pure NZ will come only when you have a symmetrical maneuver. Okay. The other reason is, someone can say, okay, then let us make one more VN diagram for NY versus V, NX versus V. The answer is that NZ has the highest numerical magnitude in a symmetrical maneuver in vertical plane, NX and NY remain constant. And the numerical value of NX and NY generally are much lower than NZ. So, NZ is the real difficult thing, the larger. So, we worry only about NZ. We don't worry that much. We do. Otherwise, if you do a turn, the engines may be thrown away by the aircraft if you do not take care of enough side force. But those numbers are far lower. Okay. This is the reason numerical values are much higher for NZ. Okay. Now, we have to see. Now, the line in the VN diagram, if you notice, was parabolic of NZ versus V. So, we have to prove that NZ is proportional to V square, only then the line is parabolic and also to the angle of attack. So, let us see how we can prove it. Okay. So, here is the typical CL alpha curve for an aerofoil and this is the cambered aerofoil just for generality. The same argument also applies for a symmetrical aerofoil. So, the load factor N, normally shown as a small n, not capital N, that is L by W, L is equal to half rho infinity V infinity square S into CL, where S is the wing reference area. But CL comes from lift curve slope into the angle of attack, assuming that it is linear and assuming that we do not go into the areas where the curve is non-linear. Okay? You would never fly the aircraft beyond or near alpha stall. So, the operational angle of attack range will be probably 5 degrees or 4 degrees below alpha stall. So, it is a linear area. So, L is proportional to V square because density of air is constant if you ignore density change in one small height. Okay. S is the wing reference area, it remains constant. Angle of attack is going to remain constant because you want lift equal to NW, you cannot change that. And lift curve slope is a parameter that is married to the aircraft geometry and aerodynamics. So, that is also constant. So, in other words, other things are constant and hence NZ is proportional to rho into V square. So, now there is a problem. When I do the maneuvers at 3 kilometer altitude, although the maneuver may be only 100 meters height, but density at 3 kilometers is far lower than density at sea level. Okay. So, the problem is that nz is proportional to rho and v square and also to the angle of attack. That means the pilot can actually be required to do a vertical maneuver at any altitude. You cannot say please do not do vertical loop at 3 kilometers, do it only at 2 kilometers or lower. We cannot say that. Correct? So you might say doesn't matter, take the highest density which is at sea level. So if the aircraft is safe at sea level, it will be safe at higher altitude. Okay. But still it's important for the pilot to know whether they are within the limits of operation or not. So now how do you solve this problem? This will be a nightmare, right? 25 different VN diagrams for each altitude. Remember you had a curve which said power variation with altitude, and we saw that the curve tilts towards the right and moves up. So that kind of drama we have to do now for VN diagram also, which is not a good idea. So can you suggest something? How do we take care of this? So is the question clear to you? The question is how do we remove the dependence of nz and v on rho and have only one VN diagram applicable to all the altitudes. So let us see your suggestions. How do you take care of it? Yes, let's ask
I am not sure, but at this guessing, maybe we can divide by half rho v square, dynamic pressure.
If you are going to divide by half rho v square, then the dependence of v also is gone, dependence of rho also is gone. Then how do you draw a diagram between n and v?
Means half rho v is my next
I want a graph between nz and v. So, what do I divide by half rho v square?
Both sides
of the equation.
Yeah.
So, L is equal to half rho. So, that means you are saying divide, take half rho v square on the denominator of the left hand side. Yes, Sushil, I think Sushil has some point. Yes. Converting it to equivalent airspeed. So, yes, that is the right answer. So, let's see how to do it. Okay. So, let us use the speed so that dependence of density on speed is gone, and that is gone through equivalent airspeed. So, for the same dynamic pressure, half into rho at altitude into V at altitude square is equal to half into rho at sea level into V equivalent square. That is how you define equivalent airspeed. So, something to what you said, something like what you said, do not use V true on the x axis, use V equivalent. Now, if you use V equivalent, then V equivalent is the same at every altitude because it takes care of the effect of density. So that is what is the solution. Okay, using a pitot-static, this all of you know, but I just wanted to quickly repeat. So you take a pitot-static tube that measures the dynamic pressure and that gives you the value of V infinity, which is the true airspeed. So, the true airspeed or TAS is indicated by the airspeed indicator. Now, this is not correct because the true airspeed indicator shows IAS, not TAS. But interestingly, I told you some many instruments are there which also have a TAS indication in the instrument. They correct it for the errors and gives you the true airspeed. So this all of you know because we have already covered this, right? So taking care of compressibility, taking care of position error, taking care of instrument errors, if you have equivalent airspeed and if you use that, then the problem is solved. By using equivalent airspeed, the variable rho can be eliminated. In that case, nz is proportional to angle of attack and nz is proportional to v equivalent square only. Okay. The other thing is about limits on the load factor. These limits, as I said, are specified by the regulatory bodies. So let's look at now two categories of aircraft. The aircraft in which people like you and me normally fly, these are the transport or commercial aircraft. So there are two important considerations in deciding the upper value of nz. The first consideration is the strength of the aircraft. Obviously, if I say that the aircraft is permitted to fly at load factor vertical of 10 and if the aircraft weighs 20 tons, it means the structure has to be designed, especially the wings, to take care of 200 tons of vertical load, which is quite a lot. That will make the aircraft heavy. Okay. So, the designer would like to design the aircraft for low load factors. The designer is interested to sell you the aircraft, the commercial organizations are wanting to sell you the aircraft. So they will design it for load factor of 1.2. But if you use an aircraft with load factor 1.2 and if the load factor increases in a slight turn, the structure will break. So the regulatory bodies say no, no, no. Not permitted to design for 1.2, design for at least so much. So from our safety point of view, the regulatory bodies insist on certain max value. So they say show us the compliance of the structure and other systems at higher load factor. Do not, we will not give you certificate unless you show that the aircraft can take so much load factor. So, please understand the limits are specified by the regulatory bodies. Left to the designers or to the aircraft manufacturers, they will design them for lower load factors because while competing with the competitor, they will have a lighter aircraft. It will meet the performance requirements, but it will not meet the safety requirements. Second thing is, high load factor also means more discomfort for the passengers. So, let us look at this table. Now, this table is taken from FAR 23 regulations. As per these regulations, typically the aircraft are divided into some categories. The first one is called as a general aviation category. Again, there you have three: normal, utility, aerobatic. So, I hope you know that general aviation basically means aircraft to be used by people who are not paying any fare, non-fare paying passengers. So who are these people who do not pay any fare for the aircraft? Personal aircraft. Okay, so let's say he wants to go to his hometown after today's class. So he just takes a taxi, Ola Uber to Juhu, gets into his aircraft, takes off and lands. Personal use. Okay. We had a very good panel discussion recently on why this category is not so popular in India, the general aviation category. Then we have utility. What is utility aircraft? Can you give an example of a utility general aviation aircraft? What could it be used for? So let's say we have to drop some medicines at some place where there is a problem, or we have to rescue some people. Now these are aircraft which are used by the agencies for non-profit, non-commercial reasons, but they are going to be subjected to slightly more loads compared to a normal aircraft. That's why the load factors are higher. Okay. Load factors higher basically means compliance in design should be shown to that load factor. So if you are going to make or buy a general aviation aircraft, the structure need to be only designed to maximum 3.8. Now 2.5 to 3.8 depends on the mass of the aircraft. That is a formula. So, but nothing less than 2.5. So you can conclude that any aircraft has to be able to take 2.5 times its max takeoff weight as the vertical load. Below that you can't get certification, but it could be 2.8, 3, 3.2, 3.5 or 3.8 for this category. If it is utility, it is more, 4.4. If it is aerobatic, that means for shows, etc., etc., then higher, because they will be going doing aerobatics, so they will be doing a lot of maneuvers and hence they will be subjected to higher loads. So there they go to 6 value. Okay. Then there is one category called home built aircraft. Home built basically means you either the kits are available, you buy the kit, assemble it together. So because it is expected that when you do home built, you will not be able to do a very good job in the structure, and also from enhanced safety, the load factor is 5. Transport aircraft between 3 to 4 depending on the max takeoff weight. So then that means this table is not for FR-23 only, it's for all aircraft. If you go to military aircraft, regulations are given by the military agencies like Defense Standard or DEFSTAN or earlier AP-970 or some other regulatory requirements. Okay. The FAA and the JA requirements are not applicable for military aircraft. They have their own requirements. In India, we have something called CEMILAC, Center for Military Aircraft Airworthiness. They specify the values. So typically, if it is a strategic bomber, that means an aircraft that is used for long distance travel, heavy bombs for strategic applications, not just go and kill whatever you see, load factors are only 3. If it is a tactical bomber, that means you have to go and evade some enemy aircraft, or if you expect to fight with some ground forces, so just like A-10 aircraft which I showed you, there it will have 4. And if it is a fighter aircraft which does lots of maneuvers, it can go from 6.5 to 9. So the highest vertical load factor is for fighter aircraft who undergo very, very tight and complex maneuvers which load the aircraft too much. Now let us go on the negative side. When will you have negative load factors acting on the aircraft? What do you think? When will the load factor be negative? When the lift force acts downwards. So when does it act downwards? We have seen in the examination also there was a question. In a vertical loop, there are some situations when you go inverted, and also when you come down inverted, you have lift acting downwards. So that is when the negative load factors come. So the negative load factors are not equal to positive one, they are nearly half. Because it will be very difficult to expect a person to be doing maneuvers while being negative. There will be a requirement, but not so much. So therefore, a concession is given. It's a concession. If the aerodynamics agencies were cruel, they would have said, give us negative 6 also. But then people said, how do you achieve negative 6? You normally don't do maneuvers when you are having negative loads. And then you don't do the acceleration. So that's why by now these numbers have come from experience. They have not come from somebody's toss or just arbitrary. They are coming on experience. People have fitted aircraft with load factor meters and measured load factors which occur. In fact, I have done that when I was in HAL Nasik. We have fitted accelerometers on MiG-27, done flight testing, because there was a requirement on MiG-27 to subject the aircraft to load factor of 5.5G with no armaments loaded and 4.5G with the drop tank loaded. So we used to do that. We used to measure the load factor. The flight data recorder used to give us the data and we had to ensure. I have a very interesting lecture on that, which I will give sometime when we have It will be a general lecture for everybody in the department, okay. So, yes, there are requirements for negative load factor, but they are typically half of the ones. Now, these numbers are generally non-negotiable, But if you go to the agency and say, look, I am designing a very special aircraft and I can prove to you that this aircraft will never experience more than NZ equal to 3.1. And if you can convince the agency by testing, by calculation or whatever they demand, they may give you a concession. Such things have happened. For example, there is an aircraft called Voyager, right? What is the famous thing about Voyager? What did it do? Why is it so famous? Do you know what is a Voyager aircraft? So why don't you check on Moodle and tell me? More importantly, from today's lecture point of view, I want to know what was the concession given to Voyager in load factor calculations or load factor estimates? Why was it given? It's a very unique aircraft. So these are guidelines. So it's like, unless otherwise stated, you have to follow this table. If you want to go beyond this table, then you need to make special provisions and proof. Yes. Yes, yes. Because see, as a passenger, if the aircraft is subjected to vertical acceleration, you are also inside the aircraft, although there is a seat belt. But if the aircraft does like this, you will not be comfortable. As a passenger, you will have serious problem, right? So, if the aircraft is going in level flight, let's say n equal to 1, and suddenly there is a disturbance, which we will see very soon, you will have some NZ. And if the NZ because of disturbance is 4, that will get added to the level flight, so it will become 5. So, if delta NZ is 4 because of a huge jerk, so you will get a you will get a force on your body which is 5 times your weight. How will you feel? You will be highly disturbed. Okay. So, if a passenger, from the passenger point of view, the load factors which the aircraft can be subjected to should not be very high. But from safety point of view, it should be sufficiently high, because if those load factors come, the aircraft should not break. Just to give you comfort, I cannot say, from comfort point of view, the aircraft can take only 1.2 load factor. If it is 1.4, aircraft will break. I hope there is no problem. So this you cannot say. Safety is paramount. So from safety point of view, there is a limit. Okay, but it cannot be that, okay, to make it safe, make a transport aircraft also NZ equal to 7. Safer, but that will cause discomfort.